I see other dignitaries were participating in this program. And dear ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. It's a very great day for Vijayawada branch particularly, and for the Golden Jubilee celebration. The presence of CIT Manohan has added glory and color to the entire celebrations. So like Naresh Chandragalli said, it is a grand finale for the great program that we have conducted during the last 4 days. So getting his time is very difficult. Nowadays, even I don't talk to him because I don't want to disturb him. ప్రసన్న కుమార్ ఫోన్ చేశాడు, ఏదో మనం లో అంటే బాగున్నదేమో అని చెప్పి వస్తారేమోనని నేను ఇప్పుడు కాల్ చేయను. ఎందుకంటే ఇస్ టైమ్ ఇస్ రిక్వైర్డ్ ఇన్ మెనీ మెనీ అదర్ ఫోరమ్స్. సో వేర్ ఈస్ కాంట్రిబ్యూట్ లాట్ ఫర్ దిస్ నేషనల్ బిల్డింగ్. ఈ ద ఫేస్ ఆఫ్ ఐసీఐ, ఐ కోట్ ఓన్లీ వన్ థింగ్ టుడే, వెన్ హీ వాస్ అవార్డెడ్ ద పద్మశ్రీ అవార్డ్ అండ్ ఈ అటెండ్ ఎ మీటింగ్, దట్ ఇస్ వెరీ జూబిలెంట్ మూడ్, ఎవ్రీ వన్ ఆఫ్ జూబిలెంట్ మూడ్. ఈ సెడ్ ఇఫ్ అట్ ఆల్ ఐ గాట్ దిస్ పద్మశ్రీ అవార్డ్, ఇట్ డజంట్ బిలాంగ్ టు సిఐటి అండ్ మనోహరన్. It belongs to the entire CA profession, and he dedicated to the ICA and the profession. Those words are still there in my mind. So whenever I see him, I see the simplicity, the humbleness. We have to learn a lot from him, but emulate a lot of qualities. So normally we have students, whenever a student attends your classes, in a classroom atmosphere. But as far as TA Manoharan is concerned, so whenever he addresses in the audience, maybe they are the employees of the organization, they are the child accountants, any forum, anywhere, the entire end of the session, the entire audience, they become his students. Like that, I think if at all you have to count the number of students here, T.A. Manoharan has got it, it is very difficult to count also, it has run into millions. So that's a great personality on a teacher's day. It's a coincidence, attending UR program is a most welcome measure. So let's not wait even a minute. So we have already made that CIT and Manoharan addresses us. It's very, very important. So I welcome you, sir, with the depth of your hearts of the entire Andhra Pradesh Chartered Accountants. Welcome you. We're very proud of you that you are here, sir. Thank you very much.
CIT and Manoharan, sir, is a postgraduate in commerce, law graduate from Madras University, and a fellow chartered accountant in public practice with 37 years of standing. He has authored books for professionals and students on Indian tax law. He is an acknowledged teacher, having been visiting faculty of renowned institutions. He was the president of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, set up under an act of parliament during the year 2006-07. Mr. Manoharan is currently a member of the Reserve Bank of India Constituted Expert Committee. He served as the chairman of the Canara Bank by Government of India, appointed for 5 years since August 2015. He was a member of the Advisory Council for Skill Development in BFSI sector and is on board of a few companies. CA Manoharan Garu was on the board of the Insurance Regulatory Development Authority and in the committees constituted by various regulatory bodies. He was the chairman of the Committee on Education and Center for Excellence of South Asian Federation of Accountants. He was a member for 2 years, 2006 and 7, of the International Accounting Education Standard Board of IFAC. He was the chairman of the National Committee on Accounting Standards constituted by the Confederation of Indian Industry during the year 2009 to 2011. Mr. Manoharan was nominated by the Government of India as a part of the 6-member board for revival of Satyam Company, which was turned around and taken over by Mahindra Group. C.A. Manoharan was a member of the Advisory Board on Banks, Commercial and Financial Frauds, ABBCFF. Constituted by the Central Vigilance Commission. He was also a member of the Appellate Authority constituted by the government with reference to the disciplinary mechanism governing the accountancy profession in India. He is a director in a few companies and widely traveled. He has addressed overseas universities such as Chicago University in USA, Warwick University in UK, and Southern Queensland University in Australia. C.A. Manoharan has been conferred with the Lifetime Achievement Award in 2005 and for the Sake of Honor Award in 2007 by the Rotary International. He received the Business Leadership Award from the Honorable Finance Minister under the aegis of NDTV Profit in October 2009, and in the business category, the CNN-IBN Indian of the Year 2009 Award from the Honorable Prime Minister of India in December 2009 as a part of Satyam Revival team. Mr. Manoharan is the recipient of Civilian Order Honor Padma Shri Award from the President of India on the 7th of April 2010. It's my privilege to present before you Padma Sri CAT and Manoharan sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Chairman of the Vijayawada branch, C.A. Srinivas Rao, and other office bearers and managing committee members, Central Council member and my good friend, C.A. Prasanna Kumar, Regional Council members, C.A. Naresh Kelly, C.A. Revati Raghunathan, other distinguished past chairman of the branch, and beloved members who have joined this Golden Jubilee program, Swarnodaya. I deem it a privilege to address Vijayawada branch on the occasion of this Golden Jubilee conference, as well as on the eve of the Teachers' Day. And I'm delighted to know that even within the managing committee of Vijayawada branch, there are many teachers who are now part of the administration of the branch, and I'm sure they will continue to contribute well. And for Vijayawada branch to scale to these heights, you know, the toil, effort, and dedication of all the past chairmen cannot be forgotten. And I salute them on this occasion because they in turn trained and groomed youngsters to, you know, lead this branch to greater heights in successive years. And I'm here because of past chairman Janardhan, who called me and suggested that I might get an invitation from the chairman and whether I'll be willing. So for Vijayawada branch, and that too when it comes from well-wishers like Janardhan or Prasanna Kumar, I cannot say no. So therefore, I've accepted this invitation, and it'll be my privilege to address all of you and share a few thoughts on the topic, you know, in pursuit of happiness, CAs to strike work-life balance in, you know, up to 11 o'clock. So sharp at 11, I'll conclude my talk. Now, as far as this topic is concerned, it is not purely a technical topic. Therefore, it may not assist you in your day-to-day profession, but I'm sure this is concerning our day-to-day life itself. And all of you will agree with me, first and foremost, we are all human beings. And only then we are known as chartered accountants. So more than addressing you as chartered accountants, I would like to address you from the perspective of this topic as human beings. Let me begin with an anecdote, then I'll move on to the presentation I have for you. You know, in a classroom, a teacher gave an assignment to all the children. 30 children were there. She said, I'm going to ask you one question. And I want a reply. The assignment is very simple. You have to reply only by one word. So that is the answer. That is the assignment. And she asked the question, what do you want to be in life? So the question was very simple. What do you want to be in life? All the 30 children completed answering it by taking about 5 to 10 minutes, because many of them did not think what they wanted to be in life. So they thought about it and expressed their answer. So after collecting all the 30 answer sheets, she was correcting, evaluating one by one, and she was ticking. Some said the doctor, some said lawyer, some said chartered accountant, architect, scientist, dietitian, social activist, politician. Every category of occupation or profession was written there. And when it came to one answer sheet, she was flabbergasted. So she called that student and said, student, what have you written? My question was, what do you want to be in life? And you have written happy, which means you want to be happy. So I think you have not understood my assignment properly. The student politely replied, Miss, maybe you think I have not understood the assignment properly, but I think you have not understood life properly. Because, friends, you will all agree, being a chartered accountant or a doctor or a scientist or a pilot is only a means for our living. It is a source of our income. It is a passion to practice. It is a passion to profess and to be engaged in. But that is not everything in life. There is something beyond that. Life is beyond all this. Profession is one facet of our life. But as a human being, our life encompasses many aspects. And that is why, and in that, ultimately, what do you want to be? You know, all of us have to aspire to be happy. So that is why I've chosen this topic of in pursuit of happiness. And therefore, let me take you through this presentation. So, you know, how do we ensure that ultimately we are not only growing in life, we are not only becoming prosperous, but we are also enjoying life, living the life as how a human being should live, and be accomplished with holistic happiness. So that is the subject of this talk. Now, world is very dynamic. It is changing. There are paradigm shifts in all walks of life. To give examples, I've listed in this slide. I will not go take you through everything, but I have to highlight one or two. You know, first one, let us say, initially human beings were affixing thumb impression because lack of education, illiteracy. But after we got educated, we migrated from thumb impression to signature. But then human intelligence evolved so much, technological evolution and all, there was forgery. There were cases of impersonation. So how to prevent that? Again, we are now moving from signature to thumb impression, that is biometric. In immigration, visa, passport, everywhere it is biometric. Even corporate offices, entry and exit is thumb impression. Even CPE programs, I think it will come. I mean, it is there in some places, biometric, entry and exit. Of course, lockdown has changed all this. So like that, every facet of human life, the way it was happening is undergoing dramatic change. 20 years ago, if you had asked an housewife to take a smallest of the decision, she would have said, I need to consult my husband. Today, every husband says the same thing. I need to consult my wife. That is another paradigm shift. So we can go on like this. And let me take you through the last two bullets. Manual to automation. What was happening manually is now automized. Industry 4.0. How many of us are visiting bank branches to deposit cash or to remit a transaction? Mobile banking, internet banking. So everywhere it is, and that was accelerated by demonetization, and now it is accelerated by this virus also. Everything is happening virtually and automized. Industry 4.0 has come to stay. Artificial intelligence, robotic technology, cloud computing, blockchain, all this has come to stay. Maybe when we all studied in the school, we were taught A is apple, B is biscuit, C cat. But the present day generation, I think A is artificial intelligence, B is blockchain technology, C is cloud computing. So that is how it is going to be. And last bullet, digital revolution. One thing we'll have to be very cautious. In the present day world, in the modern world, we need not be much worried about our children's knowledge, because they can access to knowledge sitting at their using their gadgets. In no time, they can get the best of information on any topic, any subject, any, you know, Google is the best teacher in the present day scenario. And therefore, their IQ level is bound to be extraordinary. But what we should be worried about is, do they have the emotional quotient to the required extent? We as children grew up with a lot of emotions, expressions, relations, playing around. But today they are all glued to gadgets. So IQ is growing, but EQ is declining. And EQ is all about happiness also. So the more emotional quotient a human being has, the more you can learn to be happier in life. So that is So changes are inevitable, but who can be successful in life? You know, Charles Darwin said, it is not the strongest of the species that survives, nor the most intelligent, but rather the one most responsive to change. So the one who is able to respond to the change, adapt to the change, even in this pandemic situation. So if Vijayawada branch chairman and office bearers, they have thought, now that we cannot meet, let us not conduct programs, they could not have succeeded, but they have adapted. And now I am given to understand Vijayawada branch has done a record number of virtual programs. That is because you are able to respond to the change that is demanded of you. So in this pandemic situation, all of us actually should make use of it. What appears to be an adverse situation should be transformed into a positive situation. In fact, I'm using this, my travel time is phenomenally saved. And I'm using that travel time which is saved in a most productive way, with one dream of mine getting accomplished every month. So let us, we have to use and be adaptive. So that is the, that is what makes us, you know, progress in life. I've just analyzed all the constitutions of the global economies. This word happiness, is it there in any constitution? In United States Declaration of Independence, it says life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. So the constitution itself talks of pursuit of happiness for the people. Japan constitution talks of pursuit of happiness. South Korean constitution talks of not only happiness for ourselves, but for our posterity forever. So for generations to come, we should ensure, you know, they are happy. And French constitution says towards the maintenance of the constitution and happiness of all. Bhutan measures its growth by gross national happiness, not by GDP, but GNH. And Dubai has established a Ministry of Happiness. Even in India, I'm given to understand in MP and AP, there are departments of happiness. Now, world over, you know, the UN has, last 8 years, they are doing a research and study on happiness, which country is more happy and all that. Unfortunately, out of 156 countries which are subjected to the study, we are ranked 144th. Unfortunately, and you can see the top 12 countries starting from Finland and ending with Australia. So this is measured based on various parameters. March 20th is celebrated as World Happiness Day. Of course, it is not as popular as the Valentine's Day for different reasons. But the point is, you know, unlike certain days which are celebrated only on that day, I think we have to learn to be happy for all the 365 days. And how can we be happy? The technique is, we have to be progressive and proactive in embracing technology and using gadgets. That I fully agree and endorse. That is one aspect of life. At the same time, we should not be disconnected with life and relationship. It is possible that one of us is sitting in our own house, drawing room, connected to the rest of the world. Instantaneously, you are replying to a message from America, from Australia, from Japan, in different WhatsApp groups, and you are also pursuing. Forgetting there is one human being sitting opposite to you in your own house, just at 6 feet distance, waiting to talk to you for 2 minutes. So you are connected with the rest of the world, but disconnected with the person who wants to talk to you in front of you. That cannot be the way in which we can get addicted to usage of gadgets. We should learn how to, these gadgets are tools. Technology is a tool. It can improve our efficiency. We can do multiple things in no time. We can scale up our efficiency, but that should not result in our disconnecting with the emotions and happiness and relationships. So that is the background with which I just want to take you through what these four accomplished persons in different walks of life, had to say about what success really means. You know, if you look at Richard Branson in entertainment industry, he says, in my opinion, true success must be measured by how happy you are. So he says, whether you are billionaire, millionaire makes no difference. How happy you are ultimately in life, that is what should be the measure of success. And Maya Angelou, she says success is liking yourself, liking what you do, and liking the way you do it, how you do it. So that passion, that is how you have to measure your success. Warren Buffett, the richest man, he says, I measure success by how many people love me. So and Barack Obama's wife, Michelle Obama, says, for Barack, it is not about how much money you make. It is about the difference you make to people's lives. So if you can see all this, you know, one proposition I feel like sharing with all of you. If you look back, you know, even as a CA student, when we passed, we were happy. When we achieved something, we were happy. When we completed, when we were, you know, when we got what we wanted, we were happy. So that all must have given us an impression that when you are successful, you will be happy. Actually, the right way of looking at things is, if you are happy, success will come to you. And being happy itself is a success in life. That is how you will have to approach the philosophy of life. And let me take you now to the ground reality. What I have completed now is one segment about what others have said and what is the world around feels about happiness. Now, about our own personal life, I feel we human beings have four important segments in life with which the emotion, the quotient, emotional quotient of happiness revolves around. One is the family and relations. So family and relations plays a vital role, important role in our personal life. All of you will agree. And why this segment is important for your happiness? See, Swamiji's or spiritually evolved persons, sannyasis, if you ask them, where is happiness? They'll say, happiness is within you. It is internal. You have to search for it within yourself. You, nobody else can give you happiness. I mean, that is how they will preach. They will say, that is for evolved minds. After all, we are all social animals. Our happiness depends on what happens around us. Otherwise, how do we justify the change in your mindset when you see a flower, when you see the rain, when you see the sea waves, when you see the face of a smiling child, when you get into a temple? How does it keep changing? It is all internal, but external factors also influence your emotions. And when you go to a funeral, what is your mindset? What is your emotion? So it all, therefore, family and relations play a vital role in sustaining your happiness. Let me put it like this. These four segments I am going to briefly highlight to you, if you handle them properly, if your approach to them is proper in life, your life will be happy. The converse is also true. If you bungle the way in which you deal with them, handle them, your life can be miserable also. Your happiness can be destroyed also. So from that perspective, these segments have to be looked at. So family and relations. See, there should not be any communication gap within the family. See, in Indian society, middle class family, generally three generations will live together or live around each other. That is, for example, if you take yourself, your parents and your children and yourself. So three generations. So what the communication among these three generations should be reasonably good. There should not be any gap. In fact, one elderly parents wrote a mail to their son. Son, it is long time since we met. This Sunday, why not we have lunch together? So please come down from the first floor. So that is how these days people think they are busy and get disconnected, you know, with relationships. That should not happen to us. And what at best is their expectation? Expectation of our parents will be a caring word. After the whole day, when you come back, if you see them or if you talk to them, they expect only two things: a word of kindness, you know, affection. How are you? How was the day? And care. Have you taken your food or do you want anything? If we cannot devote 2 minutes to address this to our parents, that day is wasted in my opinion. And what do our next generation expect? See, as I said, there is no dearth of knowledge for the flow for them. So you need not worry about how they will become intelligent, knowledgeable. They will know. They'll take care of it. You have to be a guide, friend, philosopher, and guide. Up to a certain age, you are a parent. But beyond a certain age, you have to be their emotional outlet. If one of the parents does not become their emotional outlet, they'll start finding emotional outlets outside the family. Don't allow that to happen. And they see your family and relations don't expect quantity of time. If they expect quantity of time, I would have been a miserable failure. They expect only quality of time. You may not be visible to them for a whole month, but one weekend you spend with them, which impression, memories will last for their life qualitatively, that is what they expect. Spend quality time periodically, maybe weekly, fortnightly, monthly, or even once in 3 months. But spend as if the rest of the world does not exist. That is enough for them. In fact, if you ask many people who are running, chasing prosperity, this work, that, if you ask them, stop them and ask them, what for you are running like this? They'll say, I'm running for my family. I'm doing all this for my family. Actually, by saying you are running for your family, you are running away from the family. That should not happen. You should always be connected with the relations. And see, many times differences come because we magnify the deficiencies and we do not realize the worth of the person. So we must know the worth, ignore deficiencies, because nobody can be perfect. We are also not perfect. And the next segment is the profession or job with which, where we spend a lot of time. So there we should enjoy what we do, like Maya Angelou said, and we should have a work culture, and we should evolve our inner energy to put our best and use our head and mind, you know, heart and mind. When something bad happens, we should not take it to your heart and feel depressed. Take it to your mind, analyze how to prevent it from recurring. If something good happens, some success comes, something, you know, joy, take it to your heart, feel happy and move on. Don't take it to your head and feel egoistic. And you must always build a trust around you in your office environment. And for both these segments, I put ego commonly in the center, because with ego, you are gone. Both in house as well as in office, that is the worst enemy. With ego, you are gone. Without it, you can go on. And let me take you to the next two segments. Health and value systems. Our seniors, I mean, our ancestors have said, if wealth is lost, only something is lost. Because you can always make it up. If wealth is lost, only something is lost. But if health is lost, everything is lost. Everything is lost. So we have to preserve our health. For that, only two things we'll have to be careful. One is the intake. What do you take as consumption? Second, what is the way you keep your fitness by exertion? So one is intake, the other one is exertion. Intake, quality of food, and the quantity of food you have to regulate. Sometimes we will be taking many things to satisfy others, or because we get addicted to consuming certain things, junk food. Please understand, your stomach is not the dustbin for those things. Anything that has to get into your stomach, which is your digestive system, it cannot go without your vetting, screening, and you have to be meticulous in that. And exertion, I have given so many options: meditation, yoga, swimming, walking, aerobic, jogging, any sport of your liking. At least one of these things you should follow and practice. And when I say you should, for example, walking, even if you do only walking, do it sincerely, systematically, methodically. It should be like brushing your teeth. Will you skip brushing your teeth because of some urgency or emergency? No. Similarly, you should not skip walking because of some reason, some lame excuse. Because the neighboring friend who will come with you for walking, he has not come, you are not going. And he also thinks like that. So convenient for both. So that should not be the approach and attitude. And music is a very good regeneration for health. Divine music, positive vibration music. Similarly, value system. See, value system, why? Because we see in day-to-day life, people who have gathered riches without value system, they have built so many houses, but ultimately they are living in the jail. So value system matters for you to be on your own and enjoy happiness. So these are the four segments, my dear friends. And just to take a look at this video, which is less than 3 minutes.
ในชีวิตคุณอะไรคือสิ่งที่คุณต้องการมากที่สุด
Actually, after looking at this short video, I feel like saying only two things. One is, what is the meaning of life? Life by itself has no meaning. Life is only an opportunity for us to give it a meaning. First 25, 30 years we learn. Next 35 years we yearn. But life becomes more meaningful when you share what you have learned and what you have yearned to those who are in need of it. The second thing I feel like saying is, we may not be able to help everyone, but each one can help at least someone. Everyone can help at least someone in this world. And this is only an illustration, illustrative video. He helps few people in his own way. We should be able to help in our own way, at least one soul, and make a difference to their lives. And the more and more lives we touch, then life becomes meaningful. You may ask, what has it got to do with your topic, happiness? Now let me tell you the genesis of this video. See, we all should evolve and make our life meaningful in such a way that we are able to derive happiness in others' happiness. That is the next phase. How to be happy by making others happy. That is the true evolution of a human being. When Dalai Lama was asked, what wonders you about humanity? You know what he said? Man himself is a wonder. Why man himself is a wonder? Because first half of the life, he sacrifices his health to earn money. Next half of the life, he sacrifices the money to recuperate his health. With the result, he is so anxious about the future, he does not live in the present. Because of which, he neither enjoys the present nor the future. He lives as if he is never going to die, but ultimately dies without actually living. You know, that is what he says in this. We should not belong to that category at all. For a moment, I am not saying money is not important at all. All that I am saying is, nothing is worth accomplishing at the cost of your health and happiness. So we should, you know, like Siddhartha, he deserted palace in search of peace and became Gautama Buddha. So Buddha deserted palace in search of peace. Many of us are deserting peace in search of prosperity. I am not saying prosperity is not important. All that I am saying is search for prosperity by preserving your peace, not by losing your peace. That is what I am saying. So peace plus prosperity is welcome. Prosperity minus peace is not welcome. That is the simple message I want to give. Now, let us identify, just as I identified four segments in life, let us identify three problems in life, major problem. I think every problem can be fitted into these three problems. What are these three problems? First problem is, you know, if you look back, young age, we have the time, we have energy when we are young, but we don't have money. When we are old, go to the last column, elderly, we will have time, we will have money by then, but we may not have energy as we had in the young age. But it doesn't mean, you know, elderly age has to be cursed or felt bad. We have to age gracefully, because at every age, for the level of energy that you are blessed with, there are many things that you can do which makes you happy as well as makes everybody else around you happy. So therefore, we must enjoy life till our last breath, irrespective of the age. Age is only a number, but you can beautify your life, make it more and more meaningful even when you are aging. So this young age and elderly age is natural. This is how it should be. But what about this middle age, where many of the I mean, many of you were glued here. I mean, you may ask, what is the definition of middle age? I leave it to you. It can be 25 to 65, 30 to 60. How you want, I mean, the moment you have started earning on your own, I think middle age starts. You can count like that. And the moment you give up earning, you retire, maybe you can say you are moving to elderly stage. So that will vary from person to person. So that is middle age. In that middle age, what happens is we know that we have energy. Definitely we are making money. So there is no, I mean, that is always there. But unfortunately, many of us feel we don't have time. We are so busy. We are so busy. We have taken up so many responsibilities. We are moving from one to commitment to another commitment, and there is no time. We are busy. We are busy. So this is one problem. Now, the second problem is ability to handle adverse situations. While we physically grow, metabolism-wise we grow, psychologically, spiritually, are we growing? Philosophically, are we growing? If we grow philosophically, spiritually, psychologically, we will have enormous amount of patience, tolerance, compassion, empathy. Then positive emotions will revolve within us. Negative emotions will not enter. See, negative emotion, take the case of ocean. Ocean is full of water. Ship is sailing on the ocean. So our life is ship. Whether the entire sea water or the ocean can sink the ship? No. So long as the ship does not permit the water to enter the ship, it will not be sunk. But the moment ship, there is a hole in the ship and the water starts entering, then Titanic will happen. So similarly, negative emotions, if we allow it to enter us, that is why. So it is actually not the adverse situations or problems that spoil our happiness. It is our inability to handle them that spoils us. People who are happy not because everything in their life is right. They are happy because their attitude towards everything is right. So they know how to handle the adverse situation. So your heart should expand so big, no problem should appear to be significant. The third problem is, generally, we get influenced by comparing with others. What the need, I mean, what others have possessed, what is their acquisitions, how they are growing, how, what. So all that, life cannot move on peacefully, happily, if you start comparing with others and then want to replicate. It's like writing an examination, trying to copy another student and pass without realizing God has given different question paper to different human beings. So by copying, you cannot pass. Your question is different from the question given to another person. You have to answer it according to your life, according to your perception. Now, what is the solution? There is a solution. What is the solution? See, there are four segments I told you, isn't it? Family, relations, health, value system, business or job. These are four. But out of these four segments, three segments are made of glass. One segment is made of rubber. Let us assume all these four as balls. Each human being is carrying four different balls. Family relation is one ball, health is one ball, value system is one ball, your practice or job is another ball. But of all the four balls, only one is made of rubber. That is your practice or the job. The family relation, health, value system, these are all made of glass. Now, there are three glass balls, one rubber ball you are carrying. Which one should be carefully carried? Obviously, glass balls. But which one we are carrying very carefully? We are devoting maximum time. We are carrying so much. We are putting all the efforts on which ball? Rubber ball. I am not for a moment saying you should ignore the rubber ball. Rubber ball is also important because that is what gives you the source of income, and with that you can attend to the glass balls, take care of the glass balls also much better. Therefore, that is also important. But all that I am saying is, please don't attend to the rubber ball by being indifferent to the glass balls, by neglecting the glass balls. Strike a balance, take care of the glass balls and attend to the rubber ball. In fact, let me put a positive statement. If only you can handle the glass balls very carefully with quality time, limited time, the happiness that you get out of that, the energy that you get out of it, you will handle the rubber ball easily. So you will be at your best. Success will come to you. And therefore, the philosophy of life, now let us look at the solutions. First solution is, you know, in middle age, please have time for attending to the glass balls. Don't say, I don't have time for walking. Don't say, I don't have time to attend to my school, daughter's school annual day function. Don't say that you are busy, therefore you cannot celebrate your wedding anniversary. So have time for that. So you must have time, energy, and money in the middle age for everything. And instead of repenting on what you have lost, what you don't possess, celebrate on what you are blessed with. Be grateful for what you are blessed with. Actually, if you list out what you are blessed with and look at the world, millions and billions will not have that, what you are possessed with, what you are blessed with. So be grateful. And the ones who are grateful for what they are blessed with will get more and more to be blessed with. And the last one is, see, please don't think God has thrust this life on you. In your life's book chapters, he has authored only first chapter, your birth, he has authored. And the last chapter, destiny, death, he has authored. They are filled up. In between, maybe because of your karma or so many things, few pages may be written here and there. But rest of the pages, he has left it to you to co-author your life. He wants you to author yourself the rest of the pages. But if you don't take effort, you'll be compelled to write them. But if you dedicate, if you get involved and you author beautifully, even when it comes to a page where he has already written negatively for you, he'll be so mesmerized by your devotion and dedication, he may allow you to erase that page also and rewrite in your favor. So that is how I think we all should evolve to co-author the enchanting journey of life. Along with God, you can have the privilege of co-authoring. So if we can understand, realize this, in fact, the cause of misery for all of us is we generally overvalue what others have possessed and undervalue what we possess. We should not belong to that category. So let us lead this life with all happiness, sustaining these four segments of life. And it has been my privilege to address the Vijayawada Golden Jubilee Conference, Swarnodaya, and greet all of you. All the very best. May God bless you with a very happy life. And I'm sure this pandemic situation will get over very soon and life will get back to normal. And then we will bounce back to be one of the most reckoned nation and the people of the world. All the very best. God bless you.
That's great. And thank you, sir. Chairman, sir.
Yes, sir. Come in. So, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I cannot spoil the message by my words or something like that. Be frank with me. And I request every member to kindly follow the same. Really, really great. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We are blessed to have this, your message on this holy occasion of our this Teacher's Day. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Prasanna sir, your word, especially with the visual on the screen.
That is already embedded in the mind. Whenever you see CHA Manoharan, all his achievements, immediately they come into your mind. Because as I said in the beginning, he is the face of Chandrakulu profession. Permanent face. Where, whichever the assignment he takes, whether big, small, anywhere, any forum, he does to the from the depth of his heart and makes it very successful, where the professional is proud of. He's not what you should do. The position should not bring you that one. You should bring the position the glory. That's what T.A. Manohar is. Sir, very nicely explained. I heard this similar topic in other occasion. I thought that is going to be repetition of the same. Certainly not. It's almost something new you are bringing to us. It's a great thing. So really, every one of us is benefited. I'm sure, this is not the income tax that we need. It's not the GST we need. Those things, we have got many material available in the entire technology, using the technology. But this is what is required. The same topic, if somebody else teaches, it will not get into our mind. There may be some another person who teaches. It will not get into our mind. It's only CAPM Manohar stated here, put it in our mind. I think not we'll be happy. I'm sure our families are going to be benefit out of that problem, including my own family. I'm talking from my house. I'm going to tell my wife right now what he has said. And whether it's good or not, she's going to be very happy. It's a great day for me, for all of us. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. Great of you, sir. Really great of you.
Thank you. Thank you.
One of our past president, C.A. Subodhji, has joined us.
Oh.